Hey there, enjoyers, and everybody who is joining us online today. A massive welcome to you all, and I truly hope you're blessed by today's service. Please know that we're praying for you and your family in this season, and that God's blessing and favor will continue to be poured out over your life. Now, before we head into our service, can you do me a favor? Since you're watching this on our online church platform, why don't you invite some of your family and friends along to watch this service with you? You can simply do this by sending them the link enjoy.church/online. And right now, why don't you drop a high 10 emoji in the comment section. This is a great place to say hi to everyone and engage with the service. So right now, let's lean in and get ready for an amazing time together. Enjoy the service.
Welcome to Enjoy Church Online. We're so excited that you're here with us today. Why don't we praise our God and lift up His name. Amen.
So much. We are so blessed to be able to join together today, to worship you together, Father God. And we just fix our eyes on you. Father, whatever our circumstance may be, whatever high sea comes, whatever storm we face, whatever mountains are in our path, Lord God, we look to you. We are thankful for you. And we just want to worship you, Lord. Come on, let's worship together this morning. We love you, Jesus. Oh. I'm at peace now, knowing I'm found. Tides will change, but you stay the same. Come on. waves come crashing, storms keep raging, yet all I have to what you say, yet all I have to what you say. For you are my hope when the high seas come, and you are the King over all my heart. You have overcome, you have overcome, you have overcome, Jesus.
Conquer all, you're standing here with
lift you up, Lord. We lift you higher because there is no other name like your name. You are worthy to be praised, Lord. Oh, Jesus, you are worthy to be praised. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
I cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hand, his feet, my Savior loved the cause of dream.
Come on, let's sing.
His body bound and drenched in tears, they lay him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed by heavy stone. As I have seen and all alone.
Oh, we praise you, Jesus.
Oh, trample dead. Where is your
Hey, Enjoyers, as we spend the next couple of minutes talking about our giving, my hope and my prayer is this, that in these challenging times, you might discover the same reassurance of provision that our family has discovered. When it comes to provision, the following scripture, as I have begun to understand it, has encouraged me like no other. 2 Corinthians 9:10 says, "For God is the one who provides seed for the farmer and then bread to eat. In the same way, He will provide and increase your resources and then produce a great harvest of generosity in you." This scripture is essentially speaking to us about supply. But if you're anything like me, then perhaps you have spent much of your life stressing and striving because of an ingrained belief that I must provide for my family. Church, this is not what God's word teaches us. The Bible tells us that when we put God first in every area of our lives, including one of the most difficult areas, our finances, then we are effectively positioning ourselves and our families under God's powerful and life-altering promise of provision. This promise of provision is this: when I make a decision to honor God with my tithe and by putting Him first in my finances, then God will never ask me to supply any of the seed that I will ever need. God will only ever ask me to steward it. Because God is responsible for the supply, the pressure of provision is that I no longer need to carry. I can worry a whole lot less, I can trust a whole lot more, because all of the seed I will ever need will be made available to me as I need it. I just need to learn how to be a good steward of it. I will need to steward my seed in times of harvest, I'll need to steward my seed in times of drought. Drought for you today might look like moments of fear and uncertainty, difficult seasons, job losses, mounting bills. But when I understand I'm a steward of seed and not a supplier of it, then I can say to God, "God, you need to provide that job. God, you need to cover that bill. God, you need to provide for that seed, for that need." And as I transfer the weight of all these things to God, my focus can remain on sowing, on planting, on being a blessing to others. Enjoyer, in these uncertain times, I want to remind you today of one certainty, that if God is first in your life, then you will always have the seed that you need, and that as you steward your seed faithfully, a great harvest of generosity will be found in you and through you. Can I pray for you? God, I thank you for all the people listening to this today, for every enjoyer, God, for every person, every family, every individual. God, I thank you that when we put our trust in you, when you are first in our lives, then God, your promise to us is to be that provider. Father, I pray that every person here, God, would teach us to steward the seed in a way that honors you first. God, we thank you for every person here, God, spiritually, mentally, physically, emotionally, holistically, Lord God. I thank you that you are their provider, and I pray that we may know you as that today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hey there, Enjoyers. I've got great news for you today. You may have already heard it, but if you haven't, get ready. Drum roll, please. We are on our way to Cambodia. That's right. You may have heard earlier this year, 4 or 5 weeks ago, I went across there with Pastor Danny and Bundit. We had an incredible time there, met incredible people. Our plan was to roll out over this year and get to a point at the end of the year where we go and literally physically plant our location in Phnom Penh. Well, long story short, you know where we're at now. But because where we're at now we have the opportunity to do church like we're doing it with you in there today. So as a result, what's happening? Well, as of today, Sunday, we are now launching on Facebook, Enjoy Church Phnom Penh. So congratulations to you all, to Bundit and Beck. We celebrate you, going to be leading the charge. To everybody that's watching online today from Cambodia, and already there's so many people leaning in, we celebrate you, we love you, we thank God for you. Get ready, we're coming to you. We're going to have a great time. We're going to worship God together. We're going to see Cambodia saved. God bless, and bye for now.
Hey church, how are you going? So good to have you join us online as we're getting around the Word of God today. So why don't we pray? Father, we thank you so much for your goodness, for your kindness, Lord. We thank you, Father, for your word, which speaks life into our hearts. It speaks life into our souls, Lord. Father, and is a food that we need in every season and every time in our lives, Lord God. So we lean in today. Father God, we sit forward in our seats. We're expectant in our hearts, and we open them up to you. Say, come, Holy Spirit, speak to us. Have your way in our lives, Lord. We love you. We trust you, and we bless you now in Jesus' name. And everybody who agreed said, amen. Amen. So good. Well, today I want to encourage you with a thought that's been kind of going in and out of my mind over the last few months, and I think it's really particularly relevant for this season that we've in, because who knows that we have feel like we've entered a brave new world. We've entered a place where once upon a time our world was fairly familiar, fairly comfortable, fairly predictable. And now we seem to have come into this season and this time where the things have changed. It feels like the rules have changed. If you thought that today, if you have ever thought that thought and gone, man, it just feels like everything has changed. I don't know how to proceed, how to go forward in this, in the way that things are now. I want to encourage you with this thought, because the rules actually haven't changed for us. The rules, if you are a believer of Jesus Christ, if you are a follower of him, if you are one of the children of God that he is looking after, I want to encourage your heart today that the rules have not changed, but instead they remain the same. Why don't you turn with me to 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 3 to 7. It says here, endure suffering along with me as a good soldier of Christ Jesus. Soldiers don't get tied up in the affairs of civilian life, for they cannot please the officer who enlisted them. And athletes cannot win the prize unless they follow the rules. And hardworking farmers should be the first to enjoy the fruit of their labor. Think about what I am saying. The Lord will help you to understand all these things. What encouraging words and what assuring words. Here we see Paul addressing Timothy, his son in the faith. As Timothy is just seeking to live his life, to live out his calling, to live on purpose, to build the church, to see his community saved. He's just like you and I, and he's in this place where he's just trying to work out, what do I do and how do I walk? And we see Paul speaking to him in this passage, and he really speaks to the church at large. And I really think that he's just wanting to remind them of what it looks like to be a disciple of Christ. You know, if we center our hearts on who we are, who we're called to be, it really does make a huge difference to us. But in his teachings, we see that he uses illustrations, which I love, because who knows that a picture paints 1,000 words? It replaces 1,000 words. So instead of trying to get into deep theology and deep, too many things that are too deep, Paul just goes straight for the picture, and he uses some great illustrations to help them and to help us to align our perceptions of what God is calling us to be, align them with his. And so I love this, because as he does this, you know, who knows that when you clarify what is, you also clarify what isn't. You pull away all false perceptions. You take away limitations that maybe sat or were sitting on you, that were burdening you, feeling like I have to fit every mold, I have to do everything. And God says, no, I just want to make it clear to you who you are and what you're called to, so that you can let those things fall away and you can walk in freedom. Because clarity and revelation always do that. They bring a fresh sense of purpose and focus, and they bring a new wave of freedom that comes through and just takes off all the excess things that have kind of been hanging off us. And I really feel like God wants to speak from this passage to us in the same way. You know, these five verses, we're told as a people that we are soldiers, we are athletes, and we are farmers. Soldiers have one commander in chief that they need to please. How simple is that? Just one commander-in-chief, the one that's enlisted them into his service. They're not looking to please everyone. They're just looking to please the one that counts. The second is athletes. The picture is athletes. Athletes need to understand what the rules of the game are. They need to know what game they're playing, and then they need to know what the prize is. So, because if I go into an AFL game and I try and take in rugby rules, I'm not going to win. I'm not going to tackle the right way. I'm not going to have the freedoms that I should have, and I'm going to be doing things that I shouldn't be doing. But so it's important that an athlete understands what they're playing, what game they're playing, what the prizes and what the rules are. And the third illustration that is used here is farmers. Farmers need to realize that their sole purpose is to produce a harvest. Their sole purpose is to produce a harvest. And if they'll focus on this, then they will get to actually enjoy the reward and reap the benefits that come from that harvest. Church, we are farmers, we are athletes, and we are soldiers. Now, if you're anything like me, these are great illustrations and I can understand them in my head and I can picture them. But if I really want to apply it to my life, I need to get a little bit more practical because I personally, I've never been an athlete. I have never been a farmer and I've definitely never been a soldier. Now, maybe you were an athlete at school. That's awesome. You've got some idea of that. I know within Enjoy Well, we have a few farmers or people who've been farmers. Hey, Peter. Hey, Steve Scott. We've got those guys. But for the most of us, these things are just images in our minds, but if we're going to really apply them to our hearts and to our lives, we need to get a deeper understanding. And so even though there's three illustrations here, for the sake of time, I just want to focus on one of them, and that is the farmer. So what's some practical wisdom from the Word that we can get to help us outwork what God is saying to us? Well, Ecclesiastes 11 verse 4 gives us a great piece of advice to help us to farm in such a way that we actually reap a harvest. It says these words, "Whoever watches the wind will not plant. Whoever looks at the clouds will not reap." Actually, I love how the contemporary English version says it. It says, if you worry about the weather and don't plant seeds, you won't harvest a crop. Nothing like a bit of straight talk. Nothing like getting it straight down the barrel. You know, that's the best thing that we can do is be those people who can just receive a good straight talk. And God is wanting to say something to us here. Because in the times that we're living, with the winds and the clouds that are brewing and the storms and the forecasts, the dire forecasts that are being blasted at us through every medium that's available, it is so easy to get distracted from the eternal, from the permanent, from the things that don't change, by the things that are really just passing through. Because this season, as large as it is at the moment, it is just passing through. This too will pass away. Which is why this vital advice is so important for us to remember. It's so important to remember that God still has a harvest for you in your life to produce. He has something for your life to produce, even in the current climate. Even in this season where we feel like there's so many restrictions upon us, where our life and our way of life has changed so much in such a short amount of time. Even in this current climate, God has a harvest for you to produce. And you cannot afford to be distracted. You cannot afford to be distracted because what you do matters. God may be the source of all life, but I love the fact, and I always champion the fact with our people, that He loves to partner with humanity. God can do everything Himself, but He has chosen to partner with you and I to see His purposes come to pass. Therefore, everything that you do and I do actually impacts on the purposes and plans of God. And therefore, we have our own part to play in the harvest coming. 1 Corinthians 3 verse 6 to 8 says this. It says, "I planted the seed in your hearts and Apollos watered it, but it was God who made it grow. It's not important who does the planting or who does the watering. What's important is that God makes the seed grow. The one who plants and the one who waters work together with the same purpose, and both will be rewarded for their hard work." You know, here Paul is speaking to a church of people who received salvation because he sowed a seed. Because he sowed the seed that was in his life. He sowed the good news of Jesus Christ into their life. The Corinthian church came into being. He's not just a visiting preacher preaching a random message to an unfamiliar church. He reminds them, "I planted the seed in your heart." They were saved because of his work. What an amazing thing. Because at some point, he went to the city of Corinth. He left where he was and he went somewhere else. And he shared the love of God and the hope that he found in Jesus, just maybe with one person to start with. Could have been a random stranger. Could have been a person he worked alongside. Because we know that he was a tent maker. So maybe it was one of the people that he was working alongside. And they just began to see something in his life. And as he's working, they started to say, "What is it that's different about you?" And he shared the good news of Jesus. And so he shared that seed that he had in his hand. And then at some point, along comes Apollos into the picture, and he watered the seeds. And as God in his perfect timing joined in, then he made them spring to life and continue to grow. And thus the Corinthian church that we read about in the Bible, made up of real people like you and I. How crazy is that? Sometimes we just read it. Oh, where do you hear that scripture? It's from 1 Corinthians or 2 Corinthians, this chapter or that verse. That was actually a bunch of people like you and I doing, learning to do life, learning to love God, learning to follow him. And they came into being and they became a body of believers. They became the church of Corinth because of what Paul did. Because of that. It was made up of real people, and this is actually how it happened, just because that happened. And so in this season that we're in, where the world is constantly changing, and it is right now, and I'm not talking about climate change, I'm talking about the very way that we're able to do life. In the midst of this, the world is constantly trying to draw our attention to everything that it's shouting at us. I want to encourage you, God still needs you to stay focused. God still needs you to play your part, because there is a harvest in your life that he wants you to produce. A harvest of lives and souls and families, individuals, young people, children, elderly, wherever they are, God wants to, wherever you are, God wants you to reach them and see their lives changed. The good thing is that we don't need to force anything to grow. Aren't you glad about that? I'm so glad that it's not up to me to make it grow. That's all God's part. But what I do have to do is, firstly, I need to stay true to who I am. This is how I sow the seed. I stay true to who I am. I want to encourage you, stay true to who you are. You're people of faith. You're sons and daughters of the Most High. You have created in his image. You have the Holy Spirit of God on your life. You have the Word of God in your mouth. So we just need to stay true to who we are. The other thing we need to do is not get distracted by looking at the winds and the clouds and the rain. Don't get distracted by the storms that are currently blowing across our world through this current wave of virus and other things. You know, that's unsettling the world around us. But instead, let's be people of peace, people who live in peace because we have got our eyes set upon Jesus, who is the author and the finisher of your faith. I just want to speak that to somebody, that the God who began a good work in you will complete it. He is the author and the finisher of your faith, of your walk, and he upholds you every day in your life. And another thing we can do as we to sow the seed is continue to do what we're called to do. This is how we do it. Understanding that there is a calling upon our lives and living on purpose, tilling the soil, watering the soil, and sowing and planting the seeds that God's put into our lives of truth and hope that's found in Jesus Christ. And how do we do it? Well, we stay focused in the midst of this current onslaught of fear and uncertainty. In Psalm 31, I love what David writes. He says, "How great is the goodness you have stored up for those who fear you. You lavish it on all on those who come to you for protection, blessing them before the watching world." See, that's it. People will see it. They'll see the difference. You hide them in the shelter of your presence, safe from those who conspire against them. You shelter them in your presence, far from accusing tongues. Praise the Lord, for he has shown me the wonders of his unfailing love. He kept me safe when my city, when my nation, when my world was under attack. In panic, I cried out, "I am cut off from the Lord." But you heard my cry for mercy and answered my call for help. Love the Lord, all you godly ones, for the Lord protects those who are loyal to him, but he harshly punishes the arrogant. So be strong and courageous, all you who put your hope in the Lord. I love these words. What encouraging words they are. But I also love David's, how real and transparent David is in the midst of all of this. He's in this place, even in the midst of the moments, he's going through this. You hear him like positive and then it's like, oh, and then it's like positive again. But he's like, he understands, he's riding the waves. In verse 22, he cries out. He says, "In panic, I cried out." See, many of us wouldn't want to admit to that. oh no, no, I'm cool, I'm calm, on the inside we're freaking out. But David is honest, and I love it because his honesty brings freedom to us. Because there will be moments, there may be moments when you are feeling worried, when you are feeling stressed, when you are feeling fearful, maybe even panicked like David was. But in that moment, the key to you coming through, the key to how you come through this is found in your answer to this one question. What will you do in that moment? To whom will you turn? To whom will you turn? Because negative feelings will come to us. Negative thoughts, they come to us. But what we do in that moment is what makes the difference. What will you do? Which way will you turn? Will you turn to those feelings? Will you turn when they come and embrace them and allow them to continue to grow in your heart and in your life and in your thinking? Or will you turn away from them and will you give the control of your life back to Jesus? Will you turn to Jesus and declare his control and his lordship over every area of your life? Will you place those feelings under his word and under his feet where they belong? To whom will you turn? Psalm 31, David cried out to the Lord, and the Lord heard him and the Lord helped him. And we can see from that moment that his whole tone changes. As he writes, he changes. In that moment, I panicked and I called out, I'm cut off from God. But God comes in, and then from that place, you hear him go from panic to declaration of faith, to courage and to encouragement of others. So what's the wonderful thing that we can be doing in this season and this time? We can be encouraging others. That's what he says, verse 23. Love the Lord, all you godly ones, for the Lord protects those who are loyal to him. But he harshly punishes the arrogant. Be strong and be courageous. And all you who put your hope in our Lord. Put your hope in the Lord. It sounds to me like he got a real revelation. Sounds to me like he got a revelation. Who knows that the dark times still have to serve God? I know that sounds crazy, but the dark times are only there to serve, to allow the light to shine brighter. That's the point where God is going, you know what? I'll allow it for a moment so people can see how incredible the light really is, how bright it really does shine, how it overcomes even the darkest moments. People can see it for what it truly is. It's just like when the plagues hit Egypt, when Moses was trying to take the people, and he did take the people from slavery into freedom. You know, God is wanting to bring people out of slavery into freedom. And it was actually the plagues that showed the true glory of God. It was in the midst of those moments when there was everywhere else in the land was dark, and the people of God, where they lived, was light. There was no darkness there. People began to see that there was a difference. There was something unique about this people. There was something amazing about this God, that he alone could do these things. And so therefore, even the dark moments, understand, are there to serve the purpose of God. God will bring you through. You're never lost in the midst of that moment. God has never lost sight of you, but he is always seeing you. See, these things, they might be outside of our control, but they're not outside of God's control. They're never outside of his. So let me gird up your heart. Let me encourage you right now with this unchanging truth. And that is, fear may come, but it doesn't have the victory. Jesus has the victory. He took the victory on the cross, and fear has never been able to take it back. So let's not let fear control us. Let's not allow it to have its way. Panic may come, but it's not. I make a decision right now. I'm not going to let it direct my mind. I'm not going to let it direct my language or my actions. Worry may come. And there are people out there that sometimes think that worry is the same as caring for someone. It's not about caring for them. Let's be those people who put aside worry and care for people through faith and through love. But when worry comes, decide that it's not going to have any place, that instead, Jesus is on the throne of my mind and my thoughts. He is the King of peace. He is the Prince of peace. And I'm going to live in his kingdom in the place of peace. So let's today, instead of worrying, instead of fearing, instead of doubting, decide that together we're going to declare Jesus reigns. Jesus reigns. Jesus rules over my house. He rules over my home. He rules over my family. We are under His protection, and all the watching world will be able to see the difference because Jesus reigns. And in that moment, I want to encourage you, as we're in this place where it's like, okay, that Jesus reigns, as we set our hearts and our minds on that, I want to encourage you to continue. As we're going to encounter people in life, we're going to encounter people as we're, even with the current restrictions, we're going to encounter people, and it's our opportunity to show them God's love. It's our opportunity to till the soil of their heart, to plant the seed that God has put in our lives into their hearts. Let's be kind. Let's continue to be gracious. Let's be true to who we are. Let's be generous. Let's be full of faith. Be people living as though we actually believe that God has His hand underneath our life and our future is secure, because we know it is. And so I want to encourage you to declare, just as Joshua did many, many centuries ago, but when he was living just like you and I, he said, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. God is so good. He loves you so much. He has not left you. He has not forsaken you, but He is with you right where you are right now. Be encouraged, people of faith. Be encouraged as you hear this word. I pray that you have been. You know, maybe you're in this place and you're listening to this word. You're listening to it on a device, on a television, somebody's invited you and you've randomly got on internet. It doesn't really matter how. But maybe you're in this place and you haven't got that relationship with God. You don't yet know Jesus as your safe place, as your protector, as your savior. Then I want to encourage you, it's just as simple as asking Him to come in. Jesus died on the cross for your sins and mine. He died to pay the price for us so that we could have our relationship restored to our Father God, who loves you and who cares for you. And all we need to do is ask Him to come in and to dwell in our heart. Ask God to forgive us of our sins and ask Jesus to come in to be the Lord and the Savior of our lives. In that one moment, in the moment of a single prayer, in the moment of a single word and a heartbeat, everything can change and you can know this God of peace that we're talking about. So if you're watching right now and you're saying, yeah, that's me. Yes, I want to give my life to Christ. Then I want to encourage you. There's a little sign on the side, tab on the side of the screen that says, raise your hand. If you want that relationship with Jesus, if you want to give your life to Him, there is nothing better that you could do for your life. Just hit that tab and one of our pastors and our leaders, they're waiting online. They just want to pray with you. They want to lead you through that prayer of salvation so that you too can know the God of peace that we're talking about. I pray that you would do that right now. But you know, for all of us, I just want to pray over this word. Lord, I thank you so much for this incredible word. Father, I thank you for every person watching, every person listening. Lord Jesus, I thank you that you see them right where they're at. Lord God, you know them intimately. You know their hearts, you know their lives, you know their needs, you know their fears. Lord God, I thank you, Father. I pray that this word would find its lodging place in their hearts, Lord God. I pray that your word would just wash through their mind, Lord God, and wash away the fearful thoughts, wash away the doubting thoughts, Father God, that it would be replaced instead with peace. It would be replaced instead with faith, Lord God. Lord, I just speak faith and peace and joy and life, Lord God, over your people as they have been watching and listening to your word. Lord, seal this word in their hearts, Lord, I pray. Father, that they might not leave and forget, but Lord God, they would hold on to this word, that it would establish and be a foundation for their lives from this day forth. Lord, we give you praise. We give you thanks in Jesus' wonderful name. And if you believe it, why don't you shout it wherever you are? Amen. Amen. Bless you, church. We'll see you real soon. Maybe.
Hi guys, welcome to Kidmania Online. We're so excited to have you here and we're going to have so much fun. Parents of younger children, we encourage you to download the Bible app for children and it's free. Also, check out our Enjoy website and our Enjoy app where we have put together so many resources for you to access during this time.
My name's Hannah and I'm so excited to praise Jesus with you today. Are you ready to get your praise on? Yeah! All right, let's go.
I was feeling lost and all alone, losing battles on my own. Then you pulled me from the grave. Now I sink in perfect grace. I found love that persists, love I can't resist, love guiding me through the unknown. You raised me back to life, you opened my eyes, since suddenly I found freedom. Suddenly Jesus.
I heard the lies and lost my way. Held the words you'd never say. Now you call me by my name. So I rest in your embrace. I found love that persists. Love I can't resist. Love guiding me through the unknown.
Today, kids, we're going to do something a little bit different. We are going to make an aeroplane. Now, you're probably thinking, I know how to make an aeroplane. Maybe not the way I make an aeroplane, because what I've worked out is people make aeroplanes so many different ways. So I'm going to show you my little way, and then we're going to have a little challenge. Let's take a look.
Okay, kids, so I've got two different types of aeroplanes here. I've got one made of paper and another one made of cardstock. So this one's a little bit heavier and this one's lighter. Which one do you think will go further? The lighter one or the heavier one? Well, let's find out. First of all, I'm gonna try with the lighter plane, okay? Here we go. Not bad. Okay, now we've got the heavier one. Let's see how we go. Who would have thought the lighter one actually went further?
Hey kids, if you could have any kind of superpower, what would that superpower be? Would it be super speed? What about super strength? Or would you want to be able to fly? I know when I was younger, I dreamt about being able to fly. How cool would that be? Imagine, anytime something was going on in your life or something was going wrong, you could just fly away. Anytime you had problems, you could just fly away from your problems. I know when I face problems, sometimes it drains my strength. Sometimes when I'm facing things that I don't really want to face, I get really, really tired and my energy levels go right down. But the Bible says in Isaiah 40, verse 31, those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. Did you know, kids, that eagles are one of the most powerful birds of the sky? They have huge wings that can be up to 3 meters wide. And when they fly, they soar. They don't have to flap like chickens trying to get off the ground. They just spread their wings and the air comes and lifts them up and they soar. How cool is that? Just to be very clear, I know the Bible says that those who hope in the Lord will mount up on wings like eagles, but that doesn't mean you can climb up on your garage roof and jump off, because you're gonna fall and hurt yourself. We can't fly. What the Bible's really saying is that when you hope in Jesus, then He will give you the strength to face all your challenges. I don't know what your challenge is. I don't know, maybe it's that you get frustrated really easy. Or maybe you have trouble with patience. Or maybe you have a temper and that temper gets you in trouble. Or perhaps you find it hard to focus on the good things that you have in your life. Whatever your challenge is, I want to encourage you that you don't have to focus on your challenges alone. God wants to be there to help you with all your challenges. He wants to give you strength. So if you're out there and you're thinking, I could really use a bit more of God's strength, then how about we pray together? Why don't you just repeat after me? Lord Jesus, thank you. Thank you that you have what I need. Thank you for your strength. Right now, Lord God, I put my hope in you. I ask, Lord, that you would help me soar like an eagle over all my challenges. In Jesus' name, amen. Why don't we give God a big hand?
Thanks for joining Kidmania Online. Have an incredible week full of faith and fun, because at Kidmania, that's who we are.